So, again, great to have Johnny Harrison on campus talking. Sorry, those of you that couldn't make it, assuming you had a class. A lot of good stuff in terms of his creative output. If you're interested in hearing more of his works, we do have, I think, two or three of CDs of his works that are in the library. Definitely worth checking out some interesting stuff that he does. I appreciated the way he was talking about the kind of abstract qualities of sound versus the referential qualities of sound, playing around with those things as a composer. And then he kind of took this left turn into a really technical topic of multi-speaker arrays, he had an adjective. It wasn't massively multi-speaker, but it was like mass. It was seriously multi-speaker. That's what he had on the slide. 96 speakers. That's seriously multi-speaker. Okay, so everybody knows their groups and their group topics. Let's see. Chris, you were out last week, but you've been talking to your group about getting up to date, or? Okay, if we need to talk, if I need to talk to this group individually, just let me know so we can kind of work out being fair to everybody as far as like what work has been completed and where you're kind of coming on board and that sort of stuff, okay? Hopefully everybody's making progress. As far as what you've been able to accomplish so far, is it looking like November 6th is going to be a presentation date when I get back, or do you think you're going to need more time? I know, Michael, you seem to say you had a lot of stuff squared away, though, right? Or kind of sort of. Okay. Are you guys making progress in your group on sampling, or? Do the last day. Okay. So we're still asking for the last day. Okay. And Eric and Robert, have you guys made work toward filters, or no? You're still kind of eking through? Okay. 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 Well, I'll leave it as is for now, then, and that's where we'll go. So that we've got a day before I leave and a day when I come back to just kind of help with things, and then do the following Tuesday. I actually have the presentation days. And Dylan will be here while I'm gone to help out with things and advise on things, and hopefully none of what we covered is like new territory for you, really, so you can jump in and help people with stuff, okay? And the object patch that I gave you last time should give you a jump start as far as what objects to be looking at. What I want to cover today, though, is a little bit different topic. This is really a two-part lecture that I started several years ago to help decipher some of the more technical bits that you might be reading about in either the reserve books in the library or some of the books on the library shelf. Definitely if you start diving into some of the conference presentations, some of the conference papers, you're going to find these things showing up, these formulas that look really complex and undecipherable that are describing what a filter does. And what I hope to do today is not Thursday, because this will take me two classes to kind of go through this material. What I hope to do today is not make you an expert in this stuff, but at least get you to the point where you're not as scared of it as you may have been before, and you can start to decipher some of these things. I'm trying to think, is it better? Might be better to pull away from the computers for this, because I don't have like Mac's demo stuff today, okay? Thursday I might get into some demo stuff, but if we can kind of pull away from the computers, come up here to the front, like I know some of my colleagues do, we'll go ahead and I'll use that for my advantage today. And sorry that things keep turning pink here on the projector. Holy cow. Okay. I'm hoping it... Heck, man. There we go. Okay, I pulled it and got rid of some of the tension in the line. Okay, that helped it. Okay, so I don't know. Have you guys encountered some of these formulas that look these kind of things? Have you started seeing some of these pop up in the readings? Yes? Okay. And they also, they will pop up in some of the help patches as well, because What you're looking at are engineering descriptions, formulas that describe these filters, these processes that are going on underneath the surface that are happening inside some of these external objects. Okay. And what I, again, what I hope to do is kind of decipher some of this for you so that you can be a little more literate when you look at these formulas. Okay. So let's first start with the difference between analog and digital. If you had, if someone, if your mom asked you the difference between analog and digital, okay, how would you describe that to her? You wouldn't? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Inside the computer. Okay. So sometimes there's the physical hardware aspect of analog synthesizers versus the computing aspect of digital synthesis. What else? What other different distinctions would you make for mom in terms of between analog and digital? Zeros, okay. Yeah, there's zeros and ones. There's a, everything is being reduced to bits, right? Okay, on and off switches somewhere at the lowest level in, on your hard drive or your solid state memory. It's being converted into zeros and ones, okay. What about the nature of analog signals? I mean, we've been using pretty consistently these objects, the digital to analog converter and the analog to digital converter. What do you know about the signal on either side of those converters?
With the signal of what digital goes as zeros and ones.
Goes in zeros and ones, yes.
Okay.
Okay. So there's zeros and, well, the zeros and ones gets at how the values are recorded, yes, okay, but there's also this component of sampling, right? Not sampling, in this case, I'm not using sampling in the hip-hop way, context of sampling, right? I'm using sampling in terms of the idea of grabbing discrete points on the line. Like, was this part of your 161 experience at some point where you were talking about continuous signals versus discrete points on the line and then kind of connecting the dots? Did somebody walk you through that at some point? A little bit? Okay. Anybody else? Because if not that, then maybe I need to even back up and talk about analog versus digital a little bit more. And pull up a different set of slides. Everybody's kind of quiet. Okay. Okay, I'm taking a risk here. When's the last time I taught 161? There it is. There should be something in here about digital audio. Let's see. No, that's not it. Ah, here we go. Okay, so let me back up then. Because if we don't even have this idea of pulse code modulation, PCM, vaguely, no? Okay. When you have digital audio, okay, there's this idea of the digital audio converter, okay? This is actually the opposite, the analog to digital converter, okay? We've got audio signals on one side coming in from a microphone that are an electrical signal. They're continuous, okay? They're moving continuously. The electrical signal is moving from positive to negative values of voltage, okay? We have to convert that voltage somehow into zeros and ones for the computer to understand, okay? That's what analog to digital conversion is doing. It's taking that continuous electrical voltage signal and chopping it up into discrete numbers that we can then manipulate inside the computer for computer music, okay? There's different steps in the process, and if you look at the opposite, going from digital to analog, or the DAC, okay, you might see some of the same steps in the process, basically. The steps in the process are not as important at this stage as what I'm talking about, what I want to kind of get across, which is that you've got a continuous voltage signal that's being chopped up into discrete numbers as into a digital signal. Okay, so how do we do that? Okay, you guys understand amplitude, right? The idea that we're deviating from the zero line. The zero line presents the center. It's silence. It's rest. Nothing is happening. And the distance from that line is the amplitude, whether it's a positive value going up from the zero line or a negative value going down. Okay, so when we start to measure this and have to turn these positive, so I mean at this point we're talking voltage, okay? This is a positive voltage change and then a negative voltage change, okay, going up and down. That's how audio signal, when it flows through this XLR cable, okay, it's analog voltage inside this cable, okay? It's positive and negative fluctuations, okay? We have to then turn those voltage differences into digital numbers, okay? That's where we first record a specific amplitude at a specific moment in time and turn that into a digital number, okay? In order to do that, we have to set aside a certain number of bits for capturing that number, okay? So if I were to set aside one bit, which is what I've kind of graphed here, okay, I would have two different values, on or off, okay? You should look at this and be able to see that on and off is not going to cut it at this point, right? Because if I have on and off or 0 and 1 representing my number, I'm going to miss all these transition points in between, okay? So what you have to do is you have to allocate more and more bits for capturing each discrete amplitude value that has been captured, okay? So if I, instead of one bit, I have two bits, okay? You should have somewhere along the lines learned, right? How many discrete values can you capture with a given number of bits? Do anybody know what the formula is for that? No? Yeah, 2 to the power of the number of bits. Okay, so if you've seen that at some point, in a 2-bit system, I actually can, and you can look at this and count up, 2 to the power of 2 bits is 4. So you can see, count here, 1, 2, 3, 4. I've got 4 discrete steps in a 2-bit system, okay? If I instead then allocate 3 bits, I go up to 8 discrete values, et cetera, et cetera, okay? So in bit depth, what we're doing is, so you've heard that terminology, right, in terms of digital audio has a bit depth, okay? Each amplitude value that's been captured by the system has a certain number of bits that's been allocated for capturing that number, okay? So the more bits, the more resolution you can have in terms of your different amplitude values. So a 16-bit system is going to have more resolution than an 8-bit system, okay? This happens with graphics, right? Everybody kind of pines for 8-bit graphics these days. Yes, this kind of nostalgia associated with 8-bit graphics, 8-bit gaming systems, those types of things, right? And then the transition to 16 and 32 and 64-bit gaming systems and all the different things that it opened up. It opened up more gradients of color, right? Okay. Same thing is true of audio. The more bits you have allocated to each amplitude sample, the more differentiation you can make of this kind of continuous line, these continuous changes, okay? So each additional bit adds to the dynamic range, okay? If you know a little bit about hearing perception, okay, the highest dB SPL that humans can hear, anybody know what that is? Before. What up? 20,000 is hertz, that's frequency, and we're going to come back to frequency in a minute, but... Yeah.
Is it like 512?
No, it's in the range of about 160 dB is when we get into, well, let's see, 160, 170 dB, I'm blanking on the exact number basically, is what's called the threshold of pain, okay? Literally when sounds are above that decibel level, you're in danger of popping your eardrums, and the bones in your ears are moving so violently that it actually causes you physical pain at that point. Okay, So that's why it's called the threshold of pain. The lower threshold is called the threshold of hearing, because literally when sound is quieter than 0 dB, it means we can't hear it anymore. It's too soft, too subtle for us to hear, our ears to hear it. Okay, so if we take that, we can kind of extrapolate out what our ideal digital system would be in order to capture the complete range of human hearing. Okay, so if you know that bits times 6 roughly dB, 6 dB per bit equals the dynamic range of a system, okay? If you wanted to design a system that was capable of a full 160 dB, you just simply say, once you can flip this around, do some algebra and say 160 divided by 6 is what, 28 bits? I think if I did that right. Okay, so ideally if we had 28 bits allocated to each amplitude sample, we'd be able to fully replicate the threshold of pain, okay, in terms of the widest dynamic range, okay. Most digital systems are going to be 16, 20, or 24, okay. And CDs, compact discs, these things that are relics of the past that you guys don't use anymore, right, okay, those are 16-bit digital systems, okay. There's 16 bits allocated for every amplitude sample that's been recorded, okay. Does that make sense? Okay, so if you take that and you extrapolate it out, 16 times 6 equals 6, so there's 96 dB of dynamic range on a CD, okay? More or less. I'm throwing out the 0.11 because it's, okay, makes the math easier, okay? Make sense? So there's a direct correlation between what your digital system can do and how much memory is allocated for every amplitude value that's recorded, okay? In terms of the dynamic range and the subtlety of dynamic differences, okay? Part of the push to 20 and 24-bit systems is that you get more subtlety, especially in quieter sounds, okay? Because if you, I won't get into that. Well, actually, yeah, I think I do. Okay, quantization noise, okay? So if I, now am I trying, instead of trying to record a specific, one single moment in time, if I want to record multiple moments in time in my digital system, okay? My analog signal's coming in, okay? If I overlay a digital system onto this, okay, what happens is in this allocation of bits, the values have to snap to one or the other bit. There is no fractional value when you're talking about a fixed number of bits per sample, okay? So everybody see the snapping action that I visualized here, okay? It kind of locks into step, okay? And what we refer to this as is quantization noise, okay? You can actually hear this in quiet sounds because what happens is you're using fewer of the available bits, and it will, because the values are trying to align with one value or the other, okay, it actually creates a little bit of crackling in the sound, okay?
Is it because they're too close to each other? Like, it's quiet? I don't understand why there's less of them when it's quieter.
Because what's happening, if the system is capable of 96 dB at full volume, okay, if you half the volume, you're only using half of the available bits, and then if you're at a quarter of the gain of the system, you're only using a fourth of the available bits. So you go from using 16 bits to using 4 bits very quickly when you turn down the sound, okay, and so you can and then you can hear this crunchiness in really soft sounds, okay. Some people like this and use it to artistic effect, basically. But typically, it's thought of as an engineering problem where the goal is to faithfully capture and then recreate the analog signal. It's seen as a bad thing when you've added noise into the system just because of the way you've digitized it. Okay. So the other thing that happens is clipping. Okay. So when you exceed the maximum of the system. Everybody see these dips at the bottom, basically, how I went from something that was in the bottom of the trough, and because I've exceeded the maximum, it just kind of clips to the top, okay? That can color your sound as well, okay, and can lead to distortion, okay? Again, some people like the distortion. Typically, though, engineers, the goal is to capture and then recreate the sound, okay? Let's see here. So dither, okay, have you ever heard of dither? Okay, dither is a little bit of random noise that is added into the system, okay? Actually, it's random noise that's fluctuating between two bits back and forth, okay? Because what happens as the in the quantization noise, as it snaps into place, if you add a little bit of randomness, the aggregate effect of all that of that randomness at a single bit, it will effectively cancel out the majority of that sound caused by quantization noise. Okay? Because you, I don't have the mathematical proof here, basically, and I don't know that you want me to get into the mathematical proof of why that happens, basically, but if you think about the fact that it's quantizing at more or less a random rate, and then you add random noise at the value of one bit flipping back and forth, it's going to cancel out more times than it does. It adds to the noise, and it, the net effect is lowering the sound, the noise floor of your digital recording. That's the point of dither, okay? And then, I mentioned dither, but there's also the anti-alias filter. Oh, no, excuse me. I haven't talked about aliasing yet. Sorry, jumped ahead of myself. I'll come back to anti-aliasing. We'll explain that in a minute. Okay, so that's a single sample. That's turning it into a digital value, recording it, the number of bits that have been allocated for it, okay? Sampling, okay? As we go march in time from left to right, right? Time is increasing on the x-axis from left to right, okay? And as we grab these points, okay, we want to grab them at such a rate that we can faithfully recreate this sound, okay? And in this case, I've got 0 and 1 here. Let's just say this is 0 seconds and 1 second. So in between these two second markers, how many times am I sampling this waveform if my red dots represent a sample? Count the red dots. 4, right? Okay, so we've got 4 samples. This would be a sampling rate of 4 hertz, to put it into terminology that you're used to hearing in terms of sampling rate, okay? So when I go to recreate this waveform, okay, it's truly a matter of connecting the dots, okay? Except that in a digital system, rather than it connecting the dots in a linear fashion, because the digital system doesn't know where the next sample is going to be, okay? These numbers happen sequentially, okay? So when this number pops out of the system, it doesn't know that the next number is down here, especially in a live situation where it's a real-time signal coming, right? It doesn't know that the next sample is going to be here, so it actually holds this value until the next value comes in and then jumps to the next value. It holds this value and then jumps up, okay? This is where that sample and hold terminology comes from, okay? So what's happening in a digital system is sampling and holding, moving, sampling and holding until the next value comes in, and then it moves, okay? Now, look at the continuous sine wave that I've drawn here in black versus the kind of fuchsia wave recreation. Is this a very good recreation of my waveform? No, right? Okay. So what might I want to do in order to get a better recreation of this waveform? Again, going back to that idea that engineers want to faithfully recreate things as well as possible.
Add more points.
Add more points? Is that what you're saying? Yeah. Sample it more frequently, okay? And so as we add points, you can see that the waveform gets better and better, okay? And we get a more and more accurate recreation of the waveform because of the sample and hold behavior, okay? And so this is where the Nyquist theorem comes in, okay? If you've heard of this vaguely. Yeah, okay. The idea of the Nyquist theorem is that you must sample a sound at a frequency that is at least 2 times the highest frequency you want to record, okay? And so this comes back to your the number you quoted to me earlier was 20,000, right? 20,000 hertz is the highest frequency we can hear as humans, okay? So if we were designing a perfect digital system in order to recreate all the frequencies that humans can hear, we would want it to sample twice that number, or 40,000, okay? And that's where CDs come in, right? CDs can sample at 44.1 kilohertz, or 44,100 times per second, okay? Make sense? Okay. So yeah, okay. So some terms here, okay, related to the Nyquist theorem. The sampling rate, which is what we just were talking about in terms of CD, 44,100. It's the number of times that you're gonna sample this sound's amplitude, okay? That relates then to the Nyquist frequency. The Nyquist frequency kind of falls out of this Nyquist theorem. So if you know the sampling rate, which typically, let's see, if this were a class being taught in the 1960s, we would be designing digital systems, and therefore we would be able to, maybe pick our sampling rate of 8 kilohertz or 12 kilohertz or that sort of thing, okay? We're in a situation where we're using digital systems that already have the sampling frequency dictated to us. So rather than saying we want to be able to capture up to this point and then, so therefore we need to double it, we need to kind of almost think of the inverse, right? The sampling rate is 44,100 times per second. Therefore, my Nyquist frequency, half the sampling rate, is 22,050. Okay, so a digital system that uses CD quality audio is not capable of reproducing faithfully frequencies that are above 22,500. To show you what happens, so there's a formula that goes along with this. But to show you what happens here, okay, everybody see the problem? When I go to recreate this, because I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 repetitions of this sine wave, okay? You have to measure the up and the down, okay? And then I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 samples, okay? So if I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, so I have to sample it at least 8 in order to be able to faithfully reproduce it, okay? And 6 is not 8, 6 is less than 8, so therefore when I go to redraw it, okay? But what I did there in running through those numbers, I can mathematically predict that I'm not going to be able to recreate this. I don't need to draw it out and connect the dots and see how it's being recreated. I can actually mathematically predict that it's not going to be able to be recreated faithfully. Okay, that's the point of the math. Okay, so the bit of this digital audio chain that should draw your attention is this. It's called an anti-aliasing filter. Okay, when a frequency is higher than the Nyquist frequency of a system, and it falls back into the audible range, because this sound will be played, but it will play as a 2.5-ish hertz wave rather than the 6 hertz wave that I originally was trying to record. Okay, so it falls back into the audible range. The way the digital system accommodates that is this anti-alias filter. Okay, aliasing is what it's called when it falls back into the audible range. And when we have an analog input, okay, you're going to have an anti-aliasing filter somewhere in the signal chain to prevent those frequencies that are higher than the Nyquist from getting into the system. Okay, so all this to say, in processing, because you guys are going to be using a live mic, right? Okay, so that's analog in. Okay, the question is, do you need to worry about aliasing? Okay, the answer is, in processing, typically you don't have to worry about this. Okay, in there are certain situations, like you guys are doing sampling, you guys were asking me about how can I change the pitch of a sample, that sort of thing. As soon as you start playing back samples at different sampling rates, you potentially can create aliasing inside the system. So it's not that aliasing got into the system. The anti-aliasing filter only protects you from frequencies out there in the world that might get into your digital system. As soon as you start at this point messing with the digital numbers and manipulating them and the way that they play back, you actually can induce aliasing inside the computer before it comes out. Okay? That's also a reason why aliasing is a much bigger problem for synthesis than it is for processing. Because think about it. Synthesis, we're inside the computer generating those numbers, and therefore we can't control for whether things are aliasing or not. Okay? It's not until it goes out through our speakers that we realize, wait a minute, I wanted a 30,000 hertz wave, and I'm getting 10. There's a problem there, right? Okay. If you're trying to generate a 30,000 hertz wave and you hear it, okay, just strictly from the fact that you know that humans can't hear 30,000 hertz, okay, there's a problem with your math, your manipulation of the numbers, okay? Make sense? Okay. Let me see. So CD quality audio, we talked about, we've run through most of these numbers, okay? The 44.1 kilohertz. Kilohertz just means 1,000 hertz, okay? 16 bits per sample. 2 to the power of 16 is 65,536 steps, okay? No, that is, let's see, that is the number of different values that can be recorded in any given amplitude sample. Okay? You think that would be enough, but people are pushing us to go to 20 and 24 just to get better, how should I put it? You know, finer detail in those softer sounds really is what 20 and 24-bit systems allow us to do. Okay? And let's see. Because 16-bit sample, let's see, max, this is where there's a direct correlation to max. I don't know if anybody's played around the fact that you can have it in 32-bit mode or 64-bit mode, okay? If you're in 64-bit mode, you actually can be processing samples in 64 bits, basically. Now, it gets reduced to 16 usually before it comes out your sound card, but let's see. Sometimes in the processing, how should I put this? Multiplying 64-bit numbers before you then, at the last point, reduce it to 16 bits yields better quality audio than working in 16 bits all the way through the signal chain. Okay, so you clean up some of your problems by keeping it 64 as long as possible, and then right at the last stage, turn it into a 16-bit sample on output. Okay, yeah?
Is all the music that we listen to in 16-bit usually like MP3s and waves and all? What is...
Yeah, waves are going to be 16 bits. MP3s actually use a frequency-based way of encoding. So it's not the same time amplitude means of recording. And so you get, there's other factors there of like smearing attacks. You lose information because frequencies that would normally cancel each other out, MP3 actually takes care of that in the name of data reduction and making it a smaller file. MP3s are usually going to start from encoding either a 16 or a 20, 24-bit file, okay? I don't know of anybody that actually, their DAW records directly to MP3. That's usually not a selling point for a DAW, okay? They usually are recording to 96 kilohertz and 32-bit native all the way through the signal chain, basically. They're mostly using this PCM or pulse code modulation in DAWs like Pro Tools and Logic and Reaper and all the other programs that are out there, okay? That's what they're using. And that's what this is what you're manipulating inside of Max with the MSP objects. You're manipulating these digital signals, okay? So let me see. That was the end of my lecture from 161, okay? So let's talk about how that relates to these formulas that start showing up, okay? Because that's where I want to get you. I want to get you so you can actually understand and decipher some of these formulas that are popping up that are describing these digital filters that operate on these 44,100 samples per second, these 16-bit samples, okay? So when we're relating analog signals to digital signals, okay, that's what this formula is meant to entail, okay? So when you're looking at an engineering formula for a filter, okay, when parentheses are used, it means analog, okay? When square brackets are used, it means digital. Okay, and those of you that know computer programming, right? What do we use in array notation, Robert? I know you know this. You took 111 with me, right? What in accessing elements of an array?
Yeah.
What square brackets or
square brackets,
right? Okay. Effectively, you can think of a recording of digital audio as an array of numbers. That's effectively what you're doing with the digital audio signal inside the computer. You're accessing it as if it were an array of digital numbers. Okay? All right, so it's no accident that square brackets show up here as well. Okay? X, when you see X means input. Okay? So the fact that it says X square bracket N means that it's an input signal. Okay? N means the sample increment, and I'll get to that on my next slide exactly what that means. Basically, it means, am I dealing with the zeroth sample, the first sample, the second sample, the third sample, etc. Okay? And the reason why n shows up on both sides is this multiplier by the sample period. Okay? Sample period, well, think of it this way. Hopefully you guys took maybe physics somewhere in your school careers, maybe? Not at college? Or no, you're saying, no, you never took a physics class?
I've never taken a physics
class. So someone who has taken a physics class or has looked at this, what's the relationship between frequency and period? Because there is a relationship there. Or I'll put it this way, frequency and wavelength. Yeah. Yeah. Higher the frequency, the shorter the wavelength, okay? Or if we think of it in terms of time, the higher the frequency, the shorter the sample period, okay, in terms of just frequencies when we're having that discussion. When we're talking about sampling rates, okay, you can take something and say that it's 44,100 samples per second, but if I, well, let's do it this way. Let's see, where's my calculator? 44,100 samples per second, right? Okay, let me actually move it down here because everything's in the middle of the screen. Okay, and if I actually did this wrong, I should have done 1 divided by 44,100 samples. So I've got an e negative 5. So that means it's 0.000226, etc. seconds in between each sample. Or to parse that out, let me think here, it would be like 0.2, let's do it this way. If it's 44,100 samples per second, that means it's also 44.1 samples per millisecond, because it's a thousandth of a second. Okay, so 1 millisecond divided up into 44.1 times equals, okay, that means it's 0.0226, et cetera, milliseconds in between each one of those samples. Okay, that's the sampling period. Okay, in a digital system, that's fixed. Because, but think of it this way, if you're going to be sampling the waveform and you want to be able to recreate it, you want it to have a very stable clock and know that the samples are always the same amount of time in between each sample, from sample 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, etc. Okay, so having a stable sample period is important for a digital system. Okay, that's why some people will get very, I mentioned people getting fanatical about bit depth, people getting fanatical about sampling rate. They can get fanatical about the clock and the stability of the clock, because that impacts the quality of the digital system as well. Okay. You're all staring at Oblique Saturday says courage. Okay, so don't forget. Okay, does everybody know the Oblique Strategies?
No.
Okay. Oblique. Quick aside here. Does it say it on this? Yeah. This is a system developed by Brian Eno and one of his collaborators, basically for when you reach a decision point and you don't know what to do next. It was a deck of cards that was originally published in 1975, and then it was updated in several editions later, basically. I'm assuming you know the name Brian Eno. That's come up in some of your classes, basically. But Brian Eno, one of his collaborators, developed this. It's a card game, but it's for when you reach a decision point and you don't know what to do. You're supposed to pick a card, and it's supposed to tell you what to do next. Okay, so the Oblique Strategies are telling you to have courage, because as confusing as this sounds right now, it's going to help you at some point, okay? I'm confident. So this is a little digital version of it, so you can click on it and say, do the words need changing? Okay, I don't know. Let's see if the words need changing. If I need to say that another way, let me know, okay? Anyway, Oblique Strategies, look it up. It can be fun. It can help you creatively get through a stumbling block sometimes, because you just pick a card and it tells you, it'll say like turn everything down, okay, and so you do that basically. So it grows out of their recording studio practice too. So there are direct references to the kind of things you would find in the recording studio as well.
That's
so
for audio.
Yeah, they were recording artists at the time. Yeah, so they're talking in that regard. But some of them are broad enough that they could apply to any artistic situation basically. But it's aimed at artists to kind of get you over those moments when you don't know what to do next, basically. Okay. And you can download it as a little, we should put it on all the computers in here. Anyway, okay. Get on that. Okay. Okay, so digital signals. Okay. I mentioned those square brackets and the array notation and the fact that there's a reason for that, okay? So thinking back to my graph where I was kind of showing you the red points on the continuous sine wave, right? Okay. If I start to number those, okay, in my hypothetical input signal that I've recorded here, I'm going to take a swig here just to wet my throat. Okay. Those individual samples can be recorded thusly, okay? So the zeroth input sample has a value of 0. The first input sample has a value of 0.1. The second input sample has a value of negative 0.5, okay? What this is doing, this is describing my digital input signal that I recorded, or at least the first 5 samples of it, okay? And I can then graph that this way, okay? So again, typically your audio signals are normalized between positive 1 and negative 1, okay? And then we can think of them as being sample 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? And if I keep drawing 44,100 of these, I would have 1 second of audio. Okay? I don't have a slide big enough for 44,100 samples, but you get the idea. Okay? So everybody get the connection between this notation and what you've probably already been looking at as kind of graphs of audio signals. Okay? Okay. Now, I mentioned X means input, okay? Well, now we need to describe the output, okay? Y is the letter that's used for output, okay? So in this formula, Xn, and here n is just a variable that means any value, okay? So for any value of input, that same corresponding value of output is going to be equal. Okay. What does that mean in terms of my digital system? If input equals output, is my digital system doing anything to the sound? No, right? Okay. So this is a perfectly clean digital system that does absolutely nothing to the sound. Okay. It takes the sound in and it passes it back out so that my input equals my output. Okay. Everybody's comfortable with this formula? It's a perfect, it's an ideal system, okay? Put it that way, okay? But I want to start from this point because it really all you're doing when you build these formulas is you're building off of this starting point. Input equals output, okay? And nothing happens to the sound. This would be equivalent to taking your easy ADAC and connecting it to your easy DAC and the sound just passes through, okay? Not a very interesting processing patch, yes? Okay? We want to do things to these digital systems, these numbers, okay, that are coming in, okay? Where we start is delays, okay? And this is not just delays like Michael and Monica are going to be talking about here. It's going to be, it's at a lower level delays, okay? The way you notate a delay in terms of these formulas is by subtracting from n, okay? It makes sense logically because if you're delaying something by 3 samples, you actually need to, when you're at the 3rd sample, you need to subtract 3 and go back to the 0th sample. When you're at the 6th sample, you need to subtract 3 and go back to the 3rd sample. When you're at the 539th sample, you need to subtract 3 and go back to the 536th sample. Make sense? Okay. So when you see this sort of notation, it's still that your output is going to equal your input, but we're subtracting some delay value and backing up a certain number of samples. Okay? Okay? So everybody understands delay notation then. Okay? Where it starts, we start to get more exotic flavors of filters and delays is when you mix and by addition and subtraction these delayed samples, these delayed signals, excuse me, to be more, what's the word I'm looking for? Literal? No. explicit, I guess. Oh, that's the word I'm looking for. Okay. Adding and subtracting in different signals helps expand the formula. Okay. So at its simplest form, this is just simply, okay, here nothing's happening. Here the only thing that's happening is I'm delaying it by some number of samples D. And in my example, I said three samples. Okay, so I'm delaying the signal by three samples. Okay, if I start to add in different delayed copies, I can get more exotic filters. Okay, and I can then add in coefficients to scale those different delayed samples, those delayed signals. Excuse me, I keep mixing up samples and signals. Is everybody clear when I'm? I guess. I'm trying to be clear in terms of using samples versus signals, but are you guys aware of the distinction that I'm making there? Because this x n minus d is a delayed signal, because as soon as I say n, it's any sample in the signal. Okay, so samples are part of signals, and that's why I'm trying to correct myself and say signals, because it's the overall signal that I'm talking about here. Okay. Okay. So delays are kind of the building block of processing effects. Okay. Not just delays, but also filters. Okay. So I'll show you how that happens as we progress here. Okay. So when we start mixing signals, we can do this. Addition. You can use addition or subtraction. Okay. And then, if you remember, let's see, well, algebra dictates, right, that we do multiplication before we do addition, okay, when we talk about the different, what is it, multiplication and division, and then you do addition of subtraction, and there's an order of operations, right, and mathematically, okay, so you're always going to do the multiplication before you do the addition, okay, so this A that gets thrown in here is what's called a coefficient, okay. Coefficient basically just means it's some value that you're scaling that signal by. So this xn minus 1, okay, n minus 1 means what in terms of delay? Yeah, I'm delaying it by one sample, okay? And the fact that it's an x means that it's what kind of signal, input or output? Input, right? So I've got an input that I'm delaying by one sample. I'm going to multiply it by some value A, and then I'm going to mix it with the current input value, and that's what my output is going to be equal to. Okay? Everybody get how I'm parsing that out? Okay. So this is what's happening inside your MaxMSP objects. Okay? This is how you're getting these filter effects out of the biquad, out of the comb, out of the all pass. Okay? It's mixing delayed copies of the signal with itself in order to achieve the overall filter output. Okay. Now, so they start to get bigger. Okay. Everybody, remember, courage is what the oblique strategies told us. Okay. So they start to get bigger. We start to build more and more complex formulas, more and more complex filters. Okay. We can not only mix delayed inputs, this x n minus 1 that's over here on my side of the screen. By looking on the opposite side of the screen, right, you see an y n minus 1, okay? And if x n minus 1 means that it's a one sample delayed input, what does y n minus 1 mean? One sample delay output, okay? You can actually capture the output as it's being fed out of the object, out of the digital filter, keep it in memory for at least one sample, and mix it back in to the signal. Yeah. Depends it on the coefficient. That's a good question. Good question. Depends on the coefficients. Like at this point, it's A and B, so there's potentially two different coefficients there. This one, I might be scaling this one by 0.3 and this one by 0.1 over here. I'm also subtracting this one versus adding this one, and that's going to make a difference as well. Okay. Yeah. Depending on the coefficients, depending on whether you're adding or subtracting, you may create a situation where they completely cancel each other out. Okay. You actually want situations where it selectively cancels each other out. Because think about it. What is a filter? Did you guys want like a basic definition for like a bandpass filter when you were in audio recording production? Or have you taken audio recording production yet? No. Okay. Robert, you've taken audio recording production. Did you do filters as you're like processing? Remember when we did the processing unit and you did like a little audio report? Yeah, and one.
Okay.
Did you do do filters or did you use some other audio effect?
I did something else.
Okay. Okay. Well, what in terms of the frequency spectrum, okay, a band pass filter, what does it do? It lets through a band of frequencies. That band of frequencies pass through the filter. Okay. A low pass filter, what happens? The low frequencies pass through. Okay. That means that we need to selectively cancel the high frequencies. Okay. This is the mathematical underpinnings that helps you to determine what's the right ratio between input and output and delayed input and delayed output in order to cancel those high frequencies so that I get a low pass filter with the characteristics that I want. Did you follow me there, Leo?
Yeah.
Okay. That's what this is. Okay. And that's what I'm trying to describe this week, is to give you the tools to kind of understand some of these mathematical underpinnings. Okay. Yeah, you're mixing delayed copies of the signal with itself.
So it cancels out certain aspects of it?
Yes.
Okay.
So that's why I said, you were like, doesn't it just cancel each other out? And like, well, it doesn't perfectly cancel each other out, and that's actually what we want. We want to selectively cancel out certain frequencies. Okay? That's what this math lets us do. It lets us determine what's going to be the characteristic of my filter if I add this with this and look at my output, basically. Okay.
If the coefficients were the same, would it be like a brick wall sort of, where just nothing passes through it?
Yeah, there. It is possible to. Well, let me see. If I were to set A and B to 0, what would happen? Right. Well, nothing or. Right. Remember, this happens before we do this addition, right? So 0 times the delayed copy means I get no delayed copy. 0 times this delayed copy means I get no delayed copy. And then I'm in a situation where I'm back to yn equals xn, and I get my dry signal again. Okay? Make sense? All right. So that's why I didn't want to gloss over your point about, aren't we going to cancel each other? Yes, that's exactly what we want, but it's controlled canceling that lets us get the different filter effects that we want. Okay. Let's see. So there's this. Okay. Notice where the equal sign is here. Okay. I've got all my outputs on one side and all my inputs on the other side of the equal sign here. Okay. It's more typical as you start, because as you build things up, it gets more complicated. Okay. This is actually the formula for the biquad filter. Okay. So if you've used where's the filter group? If you're using the biquad object, okay, what it's doing is this underneath the surface. Okay. Again, I've set it up so that there are all the outputs are on one side of the equal sign and all the inputs are on the other side of the equal sign. Okay. But effectively, the way a biquad filter gets its name, okay, one, because it's, in some sense there's two, right, because there are two sides, but there's also two sample delays, okay? We've got the undelayed output, we've got a one sample delay of the output, and we've got a two sample delay of the output. That's all this n minus two means. Same thing on the input, we've got a one sample delay, we've got a two sample delay, okay? So there's these 1, 2, 3, 4 aspects of the mixture of sound that we're creating here, okay? That's the four
by coming from the one and the two sample delays, okay? There's also these coefficients, but typically when we want to describe a sound, we don't want to set our outputs equal to our inputs. We want to know, if I want an output, how do I get there? Okay, so the journey from here to here is just simply doing that old mathematical, where if you subtract something from one side of the equal sign, you got to add it back on the other side of the equal sign. Does everybody remember that from somewhere in their math experience? Okay, you're doing that here. Okay, you're setting it so that the whole equation is equal to what is my output going to be? Okay, and you're moving all the other things to the other side of the equal sign. Okay, which means the sign actually flips on these y delays, the output delays. Okay. So what's amazing is that in a biquad situation, we can, with just simply the input, a single sample delay on the input, a two sample delay on an input, a one sample delay on the output, and a two sample delay on the output, we can create all types of filters. That's what the beauty of the biquad is. Okay. It can create a bandpass filter. It can create a peak notch filter. It can create a low pass filter. It can create a high pass filter. It can create a shelving filter. You can do all these different types of filters that you're used to using in your DAW. Okay, can all be created with the same biquad equation. Okay, as long as you know what to set these coefficients to. Okay, and there's a reason why. Let's see. I didn't get into doing superscripts here, but this is basically A0, A1, A2, and B1, and B2. Okay, so that's not—it's not B times two; it's B1, B2. Okay. It's typical to call your coefficients on the input side A's, and your coefficients on the output side as B's. Okay. But depending on what you set those coefficients to, that's how a biquad is able to actually create all these different filter types. Okay, it's really great from a programming standpoint, because once you code up your biquad filter in C or C++ or Java, okay, you've got the building block that you need to create probably 10 different types of filters, and you can crank out 10 different plugins and sell them each at $29.99 a piece, right? Okay. But actually, beneath the surface, that's why I've known this for years, right? I always kind of shrug my shoulders when I look at plugin developers selling you different types of plugins, when I know underneath the surface it's all one formula. Okay, now Waves does a lot of work in terms of massaging the code and doing extra stuff like that, basically, but some very, very basic plugin filters that they will sell you a bandpass filter separate from a low pass filter, separate from a high pass filter. When I know beneath the surface, it's all one formula. Okay. It's a sham, right? Okay. Yep. Okay. Now you know. Okay. You're buying the same piece of code underneath the surface and just plugging in five different numbers here, basically. Okay.
That's why some sounds better than the other one.
Yeah, the ones that do more work and have actually more delays, that you get a better kind of output response from it, okay? Okay, so the biquad equation. Let me see here. Yeah. I'm trying to remember why I included this. Oh, okay, because delays, right. Up until this point, we've been talking about delays in terms of the number of samples, right? But often we want to actually talk about delays in terms of the number of milliseconds. We want a 1 millisecond delay or a 2 millisecond delay in order to get the effect that we're after, okay? And there is a formula for that. If you know, as long as you know the sampling rate, that's what this FS is, and you know there's 1,000 milliseconds per second, right? Right, I've kind of done this. This collapses into divide by 1,000. Okay, you can then say two samples times 44,100 samples per second divided by 1,000 equals the delay in terms of the number of samples. Okay, So there may be some of your resources that are actually talking about, especially if you get into comb and all pass filters, where they're talking about the delays in milliseconds rather than in samples. Okay, and this is a formula for converting between these. Okay, this is the formula here. All this is doing is showing you if I want to go from samples per second to seconds per milliseconds, this is how I do the conversion here. So that I get to samples per millisecond, right? Yeah, because the seconds cancels out. And so it just gets me to samples. And milliseconds cancels out as well. I'm glossing over that because I want to get to my last point here. I don't know. I've hit you with a lot of information today, and I'm looking at the time. So I think rather than hit you with more information at this point, I'll go to questions. Because I want to end on a clarifying note. Because there's more information on Thursday. On Thursday, we'll get into impulse responses and frequency responses, that sort of stuff. Yeah.
So that's all the criteria is basically culmination of delays.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a digital filter is nothing more than specific delayed signals that have been scaled to a certain degree in order to achieve the coloration of the sound. Okay, and I'm saying digital. I mean, we're talking about digital signals here, but the same is true of analog signals as well. Analog signals are using delayed copies of the sound to create that overall effect as well. They're just not. They're not. How should I put it? They're not limited to sample increments. And actually, digital delays are not limited to sample increments strictly either. There's ways to interpolate what happens between 3 samples of delay and 4 samples of delay. But it takes more math, basically, is what it comes down to. Analog filters are doing the same thing. You're taking a delayed copy of the signal, mixing it with itself, and achieving the overall colored output, the filter. Should we consult it? What is it? We already said that. Give us another one. Remove a restriction. Okay. So the fact that we need to stay another minute, I'll remove that restriction and we will instead go. Okay. I'll have more on Thursday, but hopefully this starts to demystify some of what's going on with these filters.